Welcome to Family Discovery Day at Roots Tech. You are an amazing sight. Over 13,000 here in this room and others who will be receiving it by recording and live streaming from LDS.org, the Mormon channel, which will number about 120,000 more individuals. In addition, in coming months, these messages will also be used in well over 1,300 local Family Discovery Day events held in over 55 countries and 10 languages, reaching over 250,000 members of the church and their friends. Beyond this segment of this content will be eventually incorporated into curriculum lessons, websites, and printed publications, eventually reaching literally millions of church members. This is truly a historic event, and you're part of it. Thank you for coming. Since this is not a general conference, there are different types of speakers. You may at times feel during the day motivated to applaud, and that will be okay. At other times, you may not, and that's okay also. We would also like to let you know that earlier this morning, we held a leadership meeting with stake president, temple presidents, mission presidents, and Area 70s and their wives. Speakers included general authorities who direct the missionary, temple, and family history departments. As part of the messages about family history, temple work, and missionary efforts that should come together to complement each other, several important changes were announced that will help hasten the work of salvation on both sides of the veil. The missionary department announced two new pamphlets that have been created for full-time missionaries to be used in teaching lesson 5 from Preach My Gospel, Learning and Serving in the Church and Families and Temples. These pamphlets will be used by missionaries to help new converts and find family names and qualify them for temple ordinances. The Family History Department announced a new beginner source resource card called Strengthen Eternal Family Bonds Through Temple Service, Start Building Your Tree. This card and the accompanying online experience provide a simple guide path to help members get started with their family history, to find family names of ancestors and those that need temple ordinances. They also announced that the booklet, My Family, Stories That Bind Us Together, and now the companion website, is available in 42 languages, allowing members around the world to find names and add them to Family Search Tree. Finally, the Temple Department announced that members will now be able to print family ordinance cards on white paper, on any printer, and then bring those to the temple for temple ordinances. They also announced several other changes that focus on making the experience in the baptistry smoother and more efficient. You will notice these changes as you attend the temple. Brothers and sisters, we will now be pleased and privileged to hear from Elder Dale G. Rendlin, a member of the Quorum of the 12 Apostles. Elder Rendlin was sustained an apostle October 3rd, 2015. He will be joined by his wife, Ruth, and their daughter, Ashley. We will now invite the Rendlin family to join us.
Thank you, Elder Packer, for the introduction. As he mentioned, I'm Elder Rendlin, the most newly minted apostle. I'm grateful to be here with my wife, Ruth. And of course, when she's not with me, I'm ruthless. We're grateful to be with our daughter, Ashley. Without Ashley, our lives would be greatly, greatly diminished. Every time she came home from school, regardless of which coast she came from, it was like the awakening of Sleeping Beauty Castle. All the darkness went away, the house became alive again, and there was joy and happiness. And the same thing continues to happen now. This is a bit more terrifying than I thought it would be. But we welcome you. We're going to have a discussion, a family discussion, that is not atypical for us, except it will be a little more formal.
I'm not supposed to interrupt.
Do both of you promise to let me finish my sentences?
We'll give it a try. Don't hold your breath.
It'll be just a bit more formal because we've invited 14,000 friends to be here with us. So thank you for joining us.
Dad, you're absolutely darling in this picture. You had hair. How old were you when this was taken?
That's a photo of our family in 1963. I was 11 years old then. Ruth, would you take that and just point, not to them, but to Ashley? Oh. Okay. This is my father, your grandfather, Oki, and this is your grandmother, Mariana. This is your uncle, Gary, who was 12 at the time, Aunt Anita, who was 9, and Aunt Linda, who was only 2 1/2.
Let's see, 1963. That's right before your family moved to Finland, right?
Yes, my father and mother were called to be church building missionaries. We first lived in Haga, a suburb of Helsinki, for the 7 coldest months of my life. We then moved to Göteborg, Sweden, where we lived for 2 more years.
How many buildings did Grandpa Oki help build?
At least 3. One in Sweden, one in Norway, and one in Finland.
Okay, are they still there?
I think so. We've been to a couple of them, but your dad knows a lot more about those.
See. There's one outside of Haga Chapel. That's the one in Helsinki. There's one in Sweden, in a suburb of Göteborg, known as Västra Frölunda. And there's one in Bergen, Norway. Look, here I am, helping my dad on the construction site.
Oh, that's great. Again, with the hair. And here are my great-grandparents. Your grandparents, Dad. Did you ever meet them?
Yes. In December 1963, I met my grandmother. We made a 6-hour drive from Helsinki to the island of Larsmo on the western coast of Finland. That's where my dad grew up, and where my grandmother, Lena Sofia, lived. It was years earlier, in 1912, that Lena Sofia, my grandmother, and my grandfather, Leander, listened to missionaries from Sweden preach the restored gospel. At that time, there were only 756 missionaries in the whole world.
And isn't that something? From that small number of missionaries, some were sent to this small island off the coast of Finland to teach your grandparents.
That's right. Those missionaries taught the message of the restored gospel. And Lena Sofia and Leander were baptized the following day. They became members of a small branch, the first in Finland. Just a few years later, Leander's mother, who lived with them, died of tuberculosis. In 1917, Leander also died of tuberculosis, leaving Lena Sofia a widow and pregnant with their 10th child. That child, my father, your grandfather, Ashley, was born 2 months after Leander's death. Lena Sofia eventually buried 7 of her 10 children. It was a very difficult struggle for her, an impoverished peasant woman, to keep what remained of her family intact. For nearly two decades, she didn't get a good night's rest. She hustled at odd jobs during the day to scrape together enough food to eat. At night, she nursed dying family members. Death literally hung over their heads. In those days, timber was split and often put in the roof rafters to dry. Those timbers were then used to make coffins for those who died. It's hard to imagine how she felt. On the day we met, in 1963, I had just turned 11, and she was 87. She was stooped from a lifetime of hard labor. She was so bowed over that when she stood from her chair, her height didn't change. The skin of her face and hands was weather-beaten, as tough and textured as worn leather. She stood as best she could and pointed to a photo of Leander on the wall and said to me in Swedish, "Det här är min gubbe." This is my hubby. I was enrolled in a Swedish-speaking school earlier that fall and was just relearning Swedish. I thought she had incorrectly used the present tense of the verb when she said, "This is my hubby," because Leander had been dead for 46 years. I pointed out to my mother that Lena Sofia should have said, "This was my hubby." My mother simply told me, "You don't understand." She was right. I didn't really understand, not like I do now. Since then, I've reflected many times about the meaning of that experience and what my grandmother taught. I believe there are messages, so many messages that the Lord has given to us about working with our family history. And throughout my life, I've been able to learn and connect to the example of my family.
You know, in an odd way, this kind of reminds me of some of the history of explosives that Aunt Anita taught.
How so?
My Aunt Anita is an explosives expert, a fabulous teacher, and our family's real rocket scientist. Up until the mid-1800s, the most powerful explosive that was known in the world was black powder, a mixture of charcoal, sulfur, and potassium nitrate. It had been around for centuries and was used to propel musket or cannonballs. It was relatively stable and safe for an explosive. In 1847, though, the Italian chemist Ascanio Sobrero concocted a completely new explosive material, nitroglycerin. Unlike the mixture of things that comprised black powder, nitroglycerin was a single pure chemical compound and about 1,000 times more powerful than black powder. It was the first high explosive. It had many potential uses, especially in mining and tunnel building, as it could shatter rock really quite effectively. But it is incredibly unstable. If you drop a bottle of nitroglycerin from a small height, it will blow up. If it gets too hot, it will blow up. If it gets too cold and forms crystals, it will blow up. And if you put it on a shelf in a cool, dark room and leave it alone under perfect circumstances, it will eventually blow up.
You see the pattern?
I see the pattern.
Okay.
Because of this instability, this volatility, it was almost impossible to get nitroglycerin to where it was most needed, where it could be most useful. A few decades later, a Swedish chemist began to experiment with different ways of safely harnessing and directing the force inherent in the nitroglycerin. He eventually found that he could absorb liquid nitroglycerin into a stabilizing material called kieselguhr, more commonly known as diatomaceous earth.
Oh, what's that?
It's probably more commonly known as kitty litter.
Oh. Anyway, that scientist was Alfred Nobel, and he named the new material, that combination of nitroglycerin and kieselguhr, he called that dynamite. Dynamite wasn't the discovery of a new material, but it involved putting two known materials together to make them safer, more effective, and more useful. I don't think it's an exaggeration to say that the explosive power of dynamite changed the world.
Wow.
Wow, Ashley, you're just as scary smart as my sister. But I think I know where you're going with this. Think about the strength and comfort Lena Sophia must have gained from knowing about the sealing power. But that power is given direction as we research and learn about our ancestors. Both can be meaningful in our lives, but just like nitroglycerin and kieselguhr, the real power comes when we combine family history with the blessings of the temple. It's not just randomly mixing two things together, but the one helps direct the other.
Exactly. Without family history, the sealing authority can't get where it needs to be used. And the true value of family history is only realized because of the sealing authority. The real power is in the combination, just like nitroglycerin and kieselguhr combine to make dynamite.
I love this concept. We learn about both of these blessings in the scriptures everywhere, but combining them clearly brings blessings to our lives. Let's look at a couple of examples from the scriptures. Oh. If you'll turn to Doctrine and Covenants, section 2.
Give a moment for the slow one.
Okay. Good. The Lord tells us that he sent Elijah to plant promises made to the fathers in the hearts of the children, and this would turn the hearts of the children to the fathers. I think this is part, Dale, of what your grandmother planted in you. Then the Lord tells us that the whole earth would be utterly wasted at the Savior's second coming if this turning hadn't happened. This is a powerful message. So even if we had all the genealogy records in the world and all that we could possibly collect, without the sealing authority restored by the prophet Elijah, the purpose of the creation would have been thwarted and wasted. This was one of the very first messages Joseph Smith included in the Doctrine and Covenants.
You're right, Ruth. Without even knowing it, I have felt the strength and power of stories and examples from my grandmother and other progenitors my whole life. There's a prophecy in Doctrine and Covenants, section 128, where Joseph quotes Malachi chapter 4. He explains the turning of the hearts of the children to their fathers, and then explains these verses in the context of the sealing power and baptism for the dead. Finally, he says in verse 18, "And not only this, but those things which never have been revealed from the foundation of the world, but have been kept hid from the wise and prudent, shall be revealed unto babes and sucklings in this, the dispensation of the fullness of times." Think of that. Joseph Smith predicted that even children would understand and know things that the learned men and women of the world couldn't explain. Children and youth all over the world participate in these blessings every day, just like I did when I was 11, learning about these concepts from my grandmother and mother. People who had never heard of the Savior while living on earth can have the opportunity to receive the same blessings as those who have had the opportunity in this life. No one's left out. This opportunity for blessings excludes no one.
And the temple ordinances are central to individual power. In fact, the Lord has given us examples of this individual power. The early saints were taught about the need for their endowments before they were able to further the work of salvation. Doctrine and Covenants, section 105, verses 9 through 11, says, "It is expedient in me that mine elders should wait for a little season for the redemption of Zion, that they themselves may be prepared, and that my people may be taught more perfectly, and have experience, and know more perfectly concerning their duty and the things which I require at their hands. And this cannot be brought to pass until mine elders are endowed with power from on high. So the Lord was teaching about the importance of preparing to receive temple endowments, that they may be blessed with power from on high. This blessing enabled them to continue to be more perfectly taught to use that power well.
You can extend this understanding further if you continue to section 109, the dedicatory prayer for the Kirtland Temple. Joseph Smith prays, "And that all people who shall enter upon the threshold of the Lord's house may feel thy power and feel constrained to acknowledge that thou hast sanctified it, and that it is thy house, a place of holiness." Section 109 goes on, that they will and receive a fullness of the Holy Ghost. "And when my people transgress, any of them, they may speedily repent and return unto thee, that no weapon formed against them shall prosper, that no combination of wickedness shall have power to rise up and prevail over thy people upon whom thy name shall be put in this house."
Yes, the temple ordinances are like the nitroglycerin. They're pure and powerful. But I can see how when you add the temple ordinances to the work of studying and learning about one's ancestors, the power is greater and takes our blessings to the next level.
Dale, do you think Lena Sophia understood that when she made her comment to you about Leander? Was her understanding more powerful because she acknowledged the power of the temple along with her love for him and her family?
Now look, Ruth, we talked about this. You'd only ask one question at a time.
Okay.
All right? But let me give it a shot. This is exactly what she was teaching. Lena Sophia knew that her long-dead husband was and would remain hers through the eternities. Through the doctrine of eternal families, Leander remained a presence in her life and part of her great hope for the future. Lena was like others who died in faith.
Okay, where are you going?
Hebrews 11.
Okay.
Hebrews 11, verse 13. It says, "These all died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off, and were persuaded of them, and embraced them, and confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth." In a blazing affirmation of her faith in the sealing authority, in 1938, Lena Sophia submitted the family records for her deceased children, who were over age 8 at the time they died. That way, their temple work could be performed, although she herself would not get to the temple during her lifetime. These were among the earliest ordinances submitted to a temple from Finland. Do either of you remember the challenge that Elder Neil L. Anderson gave at Rudstek 2 years ago?
"Prepare as many names for the temple as baptisms you perform in the temple."
And last year he added 8 words and helped someone else to do the same.
Exactly. It's been called the Temple Challenge. But I've been thinking more about this challenge. And this Apostolic Temple Challenge continued to grow this year. In light of our conversation, I believe we can add an element of spiritual power to this promise. Let's read in Ezekiel chapter 47. Ruth, will you read verses 1 through 5? And then Ashley, if you'll read verses 8 and 9.
Oh, Ezekiel 47.
Ezekiel 47.
Okay.
"Afterward, he, an angel, brought me, Ezekiel, again unto the door of the house of the Lord. And behold, waters issued out from under the threshold of the house eastward. For the forefront of the house stood toward the east, and the waters came down from under, from the right side of the house, at the south side of the altar. Then brought he me out of the way of the gate northward, and led me about the way without unto the utter gate by the way that looketh eastward. And behold, there ran out waters on the right side. And when the man that had the line in his hand went forth eastward, he measured 1,000 cubits, and he brought me through the waters." Hey, remind me, what is a cubit?
It's a sixth of a Goliath.
Oh, that was helpful.
Cubit. Isn't that from the elbow to the tips of the fingers?
Yeah.
So about 18
inches. About 18 inches. Thank you. So back to Ezekiel. The waters were to the ankles. Again, he measured 1,000 and brought me through the waters. The waters were to the knees. Again, he measured 1,000 and brought me through. The waters were to the loins. Afterward, he measured 1,000, and it was a river that I could not pass over, for the waters were risen, waters to swim in, a river that could not be passed over.
So what's he seeing?
Ezekiel saw an angel that brought him to a house, the house of the Lord. There was water coming out from the house, and the further it moved, it grew. It grew to a great big river, so big he couldn't cross over. And in verse 8, then said he unto me, these waters issue out toward the east country, and go down into the desert, and go into the sea, which being brought forth into the sea, the waters shall be healed. And it shall come to pass that everything that liveth, which moveth, whithersoever the river shall come, shall live. And there shall be a very great multitude of fish, because these waters shall come thither, for they shall be healed, and everything shall live, whither the river cometh.
Ezekiel sees a river that increases as it flows from the house. The water that's moving forth from the temple represents blessings which flow from the temples to heal families and give them life.
But it gets deeper as it gets further away, and there aren't any other sources of water that would feed it. That doesn't make a lot of sense.
But that's a bit unexpected. But think of me with 2 parents, 4 grandparents, 8 grandparents, all the way back, and forward too. The growth of the river is similar to the exponential growth of our family through the generations. The blessings of the temple are available to everything and everyone. And what blessings? Everything shall live whither the river cometh. The Lord has provided a plan to overcome Lena Sophia's personal misfortune, our loss, your tragedy, in fact, everyone's calamity. He restored to the earth his priesthood and his sealing authority. Lena Sophia knew that, and so did my mom.
You mean how she submitted Lena Sophia's name for temple work?
Oh, I love this story. Shortly after Lena Sophia died, 1966,
that's
I think.
Right. That's right.
Grandma Mariana took her name down to the temple, to the genealogy department in person. The man behind the counter told her that church policy stated that someone had to have been dead for at least a year before temple work could be done for that person. Grandma Mariana replied, "I don't like that answer. Let me talk to someone who can give me a different one." She's waited long enough.
You're related to your grandmother, aren't you?
Grandpa wrote in his journal that he tried to reason with her, but she gave him a look that he knew very well, that any husband would know very well, that another word on the subject would be entirely pointless. He also added, "I probably should feel sorry for the man downtown who said that nothing could be done for at least a year. That man just didn't know what he was up against. I could have told him, but he didn't ask."
Less than 2 months later, with the authorization of the president of the church, Lena Sophia's temple work was completed. Grandma Mariana and Grandpa Oki acted as proxies as Leander and Lena Sophia were sealed for time and all eternity in the Salt Lake Temple. And did you know that now it's church policy that a person who hasn't been able to enjoy the blessings of the temple because of distance doesn't have to wait a whole year? That way, others, like Lena Sophia, can receive those blessings as quickly as possible. As Grandma Mariana told the man in the genealogy department, they've waited long enough.
What a great day that was for your family. Think of the joy Leander and Lena Sophia felt, not to mention the joy their children felt. The knowledge that these ordinances would someday happen brought comfort and peace to Lena Sophia during those long years of her widowhood. It's the culmination of family history and temple work coming together, igniting this power we've talked about today. I was recently reminded of Elder Bednar talking about this power we've been speaking of. Years ago, he started to encourage people to recognize the blessing of combining the two divine aspects of temple and family history. Here's what he said.
Family history is not a program. And then we also worship in the temple. It's all gathered together in one in Christ. And there is a power in finding one's own ancestors and taking your own family names to the house of the Lord. I've done that. I have worked with and spoken with hundreds and thousands of people who have done that work. And as good as it is, as we're in the temple, it's even better when we have done the work to be able to perform those ordinances for our own kindred dead.
Isn't that beautiful? Elder Bednar's provided a personal witness about the power we've been discussing today.
You know, President Russell M. Nelson also promised that we can see this power in our lives. He said, "While temple and family history work has the power to bless those beyond the veil, it has an equal power to bless the living. It has a refining influence on those who are engaged in it. They are literally helping to exalt their families."
Well, thank you, Dale and Ashley. That's been a very interesting discussion. And thank you for joining us.
Okay. Now today, I feel grateful to add my testimony to those other testimonies, to be one more apostolic voice in support of this temple challenge. I extend the promise of protection that's been offered in the past. Brothers and sisters, I promise you protection for you and your family as you take this challenge to find as many names to take to the temple as ordinances you perform in the temple and teach others to do the same.
So it's not just baptisms.
That's right. Not just baptisms, but all temple ordinances.
Sounds like nobody's off the hook.
That's right. Nobody's off the hook. And if you accept this challenge, blessings will begin to flow to you and your family, like the power of the river spoken of by Ezekiel. And the river will grow as you continue to perform this work and teach others to do the same. You'll find not only protection from the temptation and ills of this world, but you'll also find personal power, power to change, power to repent, power to learn, power to be sanctified, and power to turn the hearts of your family together and heal that which needs healing. I witness that Jesus Christ lives. I witness that the sealing authority has been given to earth, that these keys and priesthood authority exists on earth to bless the lives of all of Heavenly Father's children. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
Amen.
Well, it's a treat to be here with you. I'm grateful to have this privilege to introduce our next speakers that will be coming up. We have Sister Wendy Nelson, who is the wife of President Russell M. Nelson of the Quorum of the Twelve. And we have Sister Sherry Dew. Now, Sister Nelson previously taught at BYU in Marriage and Family Therapy, and as you know, Sister Dew was in the General Relief Society presidency. And so we're thrilled to have them here with us this afternoon. Now, I've been asked to take a few minutes and recap some things from the prior presentation before we let them come and share some of their experience with you. So, and then at the conclusion of their remarks, I'll have some concluding remarks as well. But before we begin, let me just kind of recap some of the things that Elder Nelson and his family talked about. First, he reissued the temple challenge from Elder Anderson from last year, and he added an additional word. Do you remember what that word was? The apostolic temple challenge. So now we've had several apostles that have joined in extending this invitation and challenge to us. Here's what he said. Find as many names for the your family names, obviously, for the temple as ordinances. Remember, he emphasized that word ordinances. Last year was baptisms, now it's ordinances. As many ordinances as you perform in the temple and help someone else to do the same. He emphasized that this is for everyone. Remember the comment? No one is off the hook. He reiterated the promises of protection as given by other apostles, and we saw some of that here in the video. And he added a promise of personal power, power to change, power to progress, power to learn, power to be sanctified, and power to heal, and power to be sealed, and seal the hearts of our families together. These promises of protection and personal power help us understand something else that President Howard W. Hunter said years ago, talking about the both halves of the blessing, and you heard that from the Renlands as well. This is what President Hunter said. He said, I have learned that those who engage in family history research and then perform the work for those whose names they have found will know the additional joy of receiving both halves of the blessing. Didn't you like the dynamite example we had here on stage? I can't pronounce those words, obviously. I bet you can't either. But combining those two things, and they created dynamite and much more powerful and controlled. Here we're combining temple and family history work together. Now, as you listen to Sister Nelson and Sister Dew, I encourage you to listen for the following. Experiences involving both halves of the blessing, acceptance of the apostolic temple challenge, and personal conversion and commitment. Now, please join with me in welcoming Sister Wendy Nelson and Sister Sherry Dew to the stage. See, this could be fun.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Wow, this is big. Good afternoon. We're delighted to be here. My name is Sherry.
And I'm Wendy. Now, Sherry, just before we begin, I have to ask you a question. Do you find it just a little bit ironic that you and I are here together at Ruth Tech's? If we weren't speaking together right now, you would be at a BYU basketball game, and I'd be here in the audience.
Yeah, tip-off was just, I think, about 3 minutes ago. I hope they can win without me. Can't believe I let myself get talked out of those tickets today. Not to mention the fact that when my brother, who actually used to work for the family history department, heard we were speaking today, he said, seriously, whoever thought of you for Roots Tech? So there you have it.
I know exactly where your brother's coming from. Do you remember all those worldwide memberships on Ancestry.com I gave you as Christmas presents trying to interest you in family history work?
And the point is,
do you remember when, for a surprise for your birthday, I went online to Family Search, looked through your family tree, and found some of your family members who needed their ordinance work completed, and printed off the cards, all so you could see your own name on ordinance cards and have the thrill of taking your very own family members to the temple? Do you remember that?
Of course I remember. I loved doing the ordinance work for my ancestors that you found. In fact, I can't understand why you stopped. I thought we were on a really great roll. Just saying.
Little did I know that all it would take to get you focused on family history would be phone calls from Elder Packer and Elder Groh. And here you are at Roots Tech. I should have called in the troops a long time ago. Well, I don't know how you read all of this, Sherry, but I take it as a sign from heaven that your ancestors have not given up on you just yet.
I hope they haven't given up on me just yet. Perhaps you've sensed in some of my dearest friend's comments that Wendy and I are here today as Exhibit A and Exhibit B when it comes to family history. Unfortunately, I am Exhibit B. That fact has been reinforced by Elder and Sister Renlund and Ashley's wonderful comments. Elder Renlund caught my attention, and he pricked my conscience with his challenge to find as many names for the temple as ordinances we perform in the temple. That's a pretty tall order for me. For decades now, the temple has been my lifeline. I love the temple. And years ago, I decided that I needed to be in the temple at least once a week. But when it comes to family history research, I've been a slacker, and I shouldn't be. My Grandma Dew was an avid, dyed-in-the-wool genealogist back in the days when everything about doing family history was difficult. Grandma served for years as a genealogy specialist for the Western States Mission, which took in parts of Kansas, Colorado, New Mexico, and Nebraska, and she traveled to district conferences throughout those states trying to motivate the saints to do genealogy and show them how to do it. She dragged me with her. I was her eldest granddaughter. I was bored stiff in those meetings, but I loved being with her. And because I was there, I heard Grandma preach again and again about how important it was to redeem the dead. She got me my own Book of Remembrance. This is the very one Grandma gave me. And she stood over my shoulder while I filled out family group sheets by the dozens. One of my most vivid memories is of Grandma in her genealogy room, surrounded by stacks of pedigree charts, family group sheets, census data, and letters she had written far and wide, searching for birth and death dates. The other thing I vividly remember is that her scriptures were always open. It's probably the visual image I have of her scriptures that has affected the way I use and mark mine, with lots of verses underlined and notes scrawled all over the margins. I can still remember one verse that she quoted in those meetings again and again. It's from the 128th section of the Doctrine and Covenants. You'll be very familiar with it. It may seem to some to be a very bold doctrine that we talk of, a power which records or binds on earth and binds in heaven. Nevertheless, in all ages of the world, whenever the Lord has given a dispensation of the priesthood to any man by actual revelation, this power has always been given. The sealing power is a bold doctrine. It changes everything. And yet, even with my grandmother's amazing example and her testimony ringing in my ears decades later, I'll confess that I did more family history research before I was 11, which is when she died, than I've done since. Believe me, it hasn't been for a lack of interest, and it's certainly not been without a whole lot of guilt. But now an apostle has declared that no one is off the hook. No one, meaning you, Sherry, is too busy. So something clearly has got to give. So you've now heard the confession of Exhibit B, which means that Wendy gets to be Exhibit A. She used to be a slacker too. But then something changed for her.
I too was influenced by my grandmother, Hazel Marie Rosenberg Coons McLean. This is a picture of her on their mission in Hawaii. When I was 17 years old, Grandma gave me all of her boxes of genealogy and said, "Now I can die." And I thought, this is going to kill me. For decades, I lugged those boxes with me when I moved from one city, even one country, to another. And the truth is that if I ever wanted to have a really good nap, all I needed to do was think of delving into those boxes. But something changed for me when I heard Elder Richard G. Scott's General Conference talk of October 2012 entitled, "The Joy of Redeeming the Dead." I was so taken with his message. I studied it more than 100 times in 2 months. I could not get enough of his talk. It felt so personal. I felt like he was talking directly to me and allowing 15 million others to listen in. At the end of his talk, he said,
"But what about you? Have you prayed about your own ancestors' work?"
I heard it as, "What about you, Wendy? have you prayed about your ancestors' work? No, I hadn't, and I hadn't even thought about doing so. To that point, just like Sherry, the thing I had done the very most about my ancestors was to feel guilty, and I had done a lot of that. But when Elder Scott said,
"This work is a spiritual work,"
I believed him, and I started to think about what I needed to do to make family history work a spiritual work for me. I was led to do several things, including one, work in silence, which is not natural for someone who loves music as much as I do, and two, create a spiritual environment in a storage room in our basement. This little room was, of course, filled with Grandma's boxes. One day in the temple, I had the impression that this little room, which we named our family history room, needed to be one of the most sacred rooms in our home. My experience with a stake patriarch came to my mind. When I asked how he prepared to give a patriarchal blessing, I anticipated him saying something like, "Oh, I study the attributes and blessings of the 12 tribes of Israel. I read my scriptures. I fast and pray. I go to the temple." Instead, he said, "I begin by vacuuming." At that point, our little family history room needed far more than a good vacuuming, and yet I could feel that I was not supposed to spend a lot of time organizing my family history in order to create a clean, uncluttered environment. I had taken that approach before for decades, over and over again, and yet, with all of my sorting and filing, I had not made even a small dent in what my grandmother had given me. Most tragic of all, I had not given even one new ancestor the privilege of making covenants with God and receiving essential saving and exalting ordinances. Elder Scott's message compelled me to do something different this time. So without going into details, let me just say that inexpensive, ready-made white curtains hide a multitude of boxes. Working in silence in such an environment led me to pray, "Please lead me to those who are ready to make covenants with thee and receive their ordinances." That prayer opened the heavens for me and helped me feel which branches, limbs, and sometimes even twigs I should pursue. I remember one night I was teetering out on a twig on my family tree and wondering, what was I doing way out there? When suddenly a woman on that twig married a man on a twig from two nights before. I can still feel the joy of noting their marriage date and place so they could be sealed as husband and wife. My dear brothers and sisters, this work is indeed a spiritual work. When Elder Scott said,
"Perhaps you have been prompted to look for ancestors, but you feel that you're not a genealogist. Can you see that you don't have to be anymore?"
I believed him, and that truth has helped me so much. Whenever I hit a tough spot, a dead end in my research, and wish I had more genealogical skills, I remind myself, "Wendy, you don't have to be a genealogist." Because of that prayer that I say as I begin each of my research sessions, "Please lead me to those who are ready to make covenants with thee and receive their ordinances," whenever I hit a block and can't find the information which would qualify a person for his ordinances, I think about the possibilities behind the block. Could it be that this person has not yet been taught by the missionaries on the other side of the veil and has not yet embraced the gospel of Jesus Christ? Could that be the reason for the block? So I move on to someone else who has been taught and is now ready to make covenants and receive their ordinances. I'll come back to that other person later. When Elder Scott said,
"Do you young people want a sure way to eliminate the influence of the adversary in your life?"
Well, as a not so young person, I absolutely did. And I determined right then to do as much family history research as possible in order to keep the adversary's destructive deceptions out of our home. When Elder Scott taught that some sacrifice would be involved, I believed him, but what could I possibly sacrifice? And then he counseled,
"Set aside those things in your life that don't really matter. decide to do something that will have eternal consequences.
I wanted to do just that, but I could not imagine what I could set aside. I thought I was using my time really well on things that really mattered. I was certainly exhausted enough, and wasn't that an indication? And then I remembered the time I spent by myself playing Scrabble on my iPad. I didn't think that little bit of time could make any difference, but I set Scrabble aside for 2 months. Now, that may not seem like much of a sacrifice, but for me, as someone who has sometimes felt a little fun deprived, I was giving up a bit of harmless fun.
So for 3 years now, Wendy has been intensely involved in family history research. She may not want me to say this, but to give you an idea about the scope of her work, she has found more than 10,000 names, and each name has been sourced and merged, whatever that means.
Someday you'll understand.
Apparently it's important. And she has found those names on family lines where supposedly most of the work had already been done. Have you heard that before? So Wendy, we're here for you to teach us. What do you know today that you didn't know 3 years ago when you listened to Elder Scott and heard the message and began?
Well, actually, I learned several things in just the first 2 weeks of this new approach to family history. First, I learned that those on the other side of the veil are very much alive, and actually not that cheerful about being called dead. You've had experiences as you've helped my ancestors.
I have. Not very long ago, I was in my office, buried with work, a very packed day, but the name of a woman whose initiatory I had done just a couple of days before, her name was Eliza, kept flashing through my mind. I mean, actually, it was more like she was yanking on my collar, and for several hours, she did not let up. It was just incessant. Finally, I couldn't take it anymore. So I rearranged my schedule for the afternoon and slipped across the street to the Salt Lake Temple to perform her endowment. Her insistence that day was absolutely palpable. Then just a few days ago, I did the initiatory for a mother and her four daughters. I did the mothers first, and then I had put the daughters in age of their birth, and I didn't really sense anything unusual when I did the mother's initiatory. But the minute I started helping her eldest daughter, I knew the mother was there, almost as though she had come to make sure that all of her daughter's work was done and that it was done correctly. Not only could I tell she was there, I could sense the love this mother has for her girls. It was such a tender experience for me and for the ordnance workers. So clearly, those on the other side are alive. So, what else have you learned?
Well, I've learned just what your two examples have taught us, that those on the other side are eager, well, actually they're desperate, for their ordinances to be performed, and many know when and where their ordinances will take place. One Sunday afternoon, I grabbed my cell phone and recorded my husband telling of this experience, which means so much to him and to me.
Do you remember the wonderful day we had found 76 ancestors?
Yes, you'd given me 76 cards for people who needed the baptism and confirmation ordinances performed. And so I took those and left them with the folks at the desk and returned later on at the close of the day when my meetings were over. And when I came back to retrieve those cards, I was greeted by a committee of people who wanted to tell me what had happened that day. Apparently, one of the young women had received the name of Annie McIntyre, and when that name was called out in the baptismal font, she shouted out, "I know her. She came to me last night in my dream, and she said that I was going to be baptized for her that very day in the temple." Then again, when it was time for the confirmation to be done, same young woman got that same name, Annie McIntyre, and she said, "I had the feeling like she was there and approving of the ordinances that had been performed for her." There's
a great feeling of accomplishment when those vicarious ordinances are performed. Those people are ready, they're waiting, they're anxious.
Anything else you want to add about family history work?
Well, may I say something that you wouldn't want me to say? But I have noticed a difference in you. When you're immersed in this work serving others on the other side of the veil, you are a happy girl. And of course, you're always happy. You're always wonderful. But there's a special spirit about you when you've been involved in redemption of these folks who are on the other side of the veil, who are yearning for their ordinances to be done.
Thank you, dear.
Do you love that? I love that. One of the reasons I love that story is that it shows yet again the spiritual strength of our young women. They can dream dreams. They can receive revelation. I just love everything about that. Okay, what else have you learned?
Sherry, didn't you give a general conference talk entitled, "Are We Not All Mothers?" Well, after just the first 2 weeks of my feeble attempts at family history, I was ready to write the book, "Are We Not All Cousins?" Because here I am with deep Scottish and Swiss roots. But one day, as I was researching, something like this happened. An ancestor married a man whose mother was Italian. Suddenly, I felt a great connection to Italy and found myself craving ravioli.
There you go. That's how it goes.
It makes me think of this photo of my husband and me at the famous banyan tree on the north shore of Oahu. Talk about roots and branches.
I've been to that same banyan tree, and it is amazing. Young banyan plants put out aerial roots, which then put out secondary roots, and on and on. Over time, that one tree can become a family of trees. In many Asian countries, banyan trees are actually planted at places where they know families and communities will gather so that they can enjoy the protection and shade of the tree. I just think it's a wonderful metaphor for the fact that what begins as one couple can lead to endless posterity, and that the extended family can provide great protection to every member of that family. Wendy, I know there's something else you've learned, because I've witnessed it too. I've been watching it too. It's that when the Lord knows you're serious about family history, which He knows she's serious about family history, people show up to help. I remember very early on you coming back from the Bountiful Temple, having had an amazing experience there. Will you share that with us?
I'd love to. Actually, I went to the Bountiful Temple to help one of my ancestors receive her endowment. And I thought while I was there, I would have ordinance cards printed off from my second ever family ordinance request form. I intended to dash home right after that. However, with those ordinance cards in my hand, I could feel I was not to leave the temple without having those people baptized. The temple worker who welcomed me to the baptistry apologized that there were no proxies there who could help me. It was a Wednesday afternoon, and all the youth were still in school, so I asked if I could go sit by the font. I could feel that I was not to leave the temple. And there I was alone, praying by the baptismal font. I prayed, "If it is important for these people to be baptized today, please send the proxies." Shortly, a man and a woman, a boy and girl, came and sat right in front of me. I assumed they were there to do their own family names. I didn't know if I dared ask them to help me, but for my ancestors, I'm willing to do almost anything. So I leaned forward and with some hesitation asked, "Do you have your own family names to do?" The man, whom I'd never met, answered, "No, Sister Nelson, we believe we are here to help you."
Wendy came home from that experience just amazed and thrilled with what had happened. And since then, she's seen that proxies are often very literally heaven sent. Plus, she's basically enlisted and prevailed upon every single person we know. Friends, her family and mine, neighbors, and of course, ward members. She got our Relief Society sisters involved. I think she even motivated the high priest to do some work. And the youth, not coming down on high priest, by the way. And the youth in our ward have helped a lot.
All of that is true. Listen to what our Young Men's president, Brother Dave Wolf Graham, had to say.
Brother Wolf Graham, you've been a bishop, a state president, a mission president in Milan, Italy. Your calling presently in our ward is?
Young Men's president.
Can you speak about that?
We tried to get a little more serious about our family history work. We just weren't consistent at getting names and then going to the temple. And then Sister Nelson, you came along and asked us if we would do family history work. And so we decided as a quorum that we would go to the temple monthly and do family history work. And I think another thing that helped with this consistency is that we go to the temple at 5 a.m. And parents have expressed concern that their young men aren't going to get the necessary rest. And yet I have never heard one young man say how tired they've been that day. In fact, just the opposite. And I can testify for myself that it's not just the youth, that the energy I expend to get up in the morning, it's attitude during the day. This family history work that we're doing at the temple, it's not just work. We're actually bringing salvation, opening the door for salvation to those who have passed on, because they aren't names, they're real people.
Brother Wolf Graham had the same experience taking those young men at 5 a.m. as I had as a Laurel advisor taking the young women. I learned through that experience an interesting thing, that it's actually easier to motivate someone to do something difficult, like get up and go to the temple at 5 a.m., than it is to motivate them to do something easy. I think that's because our spirits are divinely endowed with the desire to progress. Accepting righteous challenges is part of the Lord's plan for each of us.
So, Sherry, do you think there's any chance that that particular
principle... I just knew this was coming. I could hear this coming, yes.
Could there be any chance that that particular principle, that it's actually easier to get someone to do something difficult than something easy, could in any way apply to you and family history?
You'd think so, wouldn't you?
I also interviewed one of the young priests in our ward who was proxy for my ancestors. Let's hear what Cade Larson has to say.
So tell me your name.
I am Cade Larson.
And you are how old?
I'm 16 years old.
Tell me about the first time you ever did proxy work for our ancestors. Can you remember the first time?
Yes, I can. I remember I was 14, I was a new teacher, and I remember hearing about in quorum that we were going to go try and go to the temple on Tuesday morning at like 5 a.m., and I was kind of like, oh, I don't know if I want to go or not. And I woke up and I went, and I remember that it was just the greatest time I've ever had. It was amazing. I just felt the spirit so strong. And it was actually my first time going to the temple. My life changed drastically. Like, I felt like I could just do a lot more, and that when I read my scriptures, it was a lot more meaningful. And I remember that I had football after school too, and that I didn't feel tired, nothing happened. I felt better than I've ever felt in a while. And it was great. It all started with going to the temple in the morning.
Cade is a perfect example of why we want our youth serving as proxies in the temple, because the temple changes them. They get to serve and help someone else, but through serving, they are changed. We've seen this again and again, and not just from the youth in our ward, but in the lives of many of the young adults in the institute class where Wendy and I used to team teach.
Let me just add that several of those institute students have now started to find their own family names by doing their own work on Family Search. So now they are totally involved.
Let us just share the comments from just one of these institute students. I think Wendy could show you countless emails, but here's one email that came from a young adult woman that was in our class. She said, "Everything about my life has changed. My life has changed completely. My temple experiences are much more meaningful. I have more spiritual experiences, and I have learned more about those on the other side of the veil and how the Spirit communicates with me. I have more peace and power to deal with trials and greater ability to receive revelation. It has helped everyone around me, especially my family. I am even a better nurse. People at work have even talked to me about it." Family history and temple work change us. That's what this young adult woman just told us. And I have to say that, could I just add something to what President Nelson said about you?
You mean that I'm such a happy person?
That you're such a happy person generally.
Yeah.
But happier,
always,
of course, when you're doing family history. I've seen the dramatic impact, and it is dramatic, that family history has had on Wendy. I've seen a softening in terms of her attitude about certain things. The work has energized her, and perhaps most of all, she's been strengthened to handle the unique stress and the demands of her life. The Lord seems to be showering His grace upon her, and the changes have been striking. Now, is there anything else you'd like to share about what you've learned?
Well, I've learned that family history research is really fun. It's actually even more fun than Scrabble. More fun than anything I used to do to have a little R&R.
More fun than reruns of Monk and Matlock. And I've told you a lot about her by telling you that.
It's hard to believe, isn't it? But yes, now for me, super sleuthing a mother's maiden name trumps watching any detective movie I used to enjoy. And no one is more surprised than I that I feel this way.
So, brothers and sisters, what we're really saying today is that the combination of family history and temple work has a unique power to build faith and testimony. Because when all is said and done, this work is all about people. It's about giving every one of our Heavenly Father's sons and daughters the chance to make covenants and receive saving, exalting ordinances. It's all about helping His children return home to Him. You know, the older I get, the more real the eternal nature of our lives becomes to me. For example, Wendy and I are often asked how we met and how long we've known each other. Well, there are a couple ways to answer that, probably. One way would be to say that we met 19 years ago. Another is to say that we've known each other for eons. We are talking today and have been talking about families and how priceless those relationships are. But one of Heavenly Father's most generous gifts to me has been my friends. I love my friends. I'm so grateful for them. And I'm so grateful in a special way for this friend.
When I met Sherry, I finally understood what Elder Orson F. Whitney taught. Quote, "Why are we drawn to certain persons and they to us as if we had always known each other? We believe ties formed in this life will be continued in the life to come. Then why not believe that some of them at least have been resumed in this stage of existence?" End quote. No one, no friend has ever done or would ever do what Sherry has done for me. Sherry, did I say that the way you want me to say it?
Now you know a little something about our friendship, right? That's how that goes most of the time. The bottom line is that this mortal life is just a small slice of our eternal existence. We all know that. Today we've talked primarily about how eager those living on the other side of the veil are for our help. But Wendy and I have come to appreciate just how eager those living on the other side are to help us. There we go. President Joseph F. Smith, we want to quote now from President Joseph F. Smith. President Joseph F. Smith taught something truly profound when he said this: "When messengers are sent to minister to the inhabitants of this earth, they are not strangers, but from the ranks of our kindred and friends. In like manner, our fathers and mothers, brothers, sisters, and friends who have passed away from this earth, having been faithful and worthy to enjoy these rights and privileges, may have a mission given them to visit their relatives and friends upon the earth again, bringing from the divine presence messages of love, of warning, of reproof, and instruction to those whom they have learned to love in the flesh."
Well, I know that's true. Sometimes I hear counsel that sounds a whole lot like my mother.
What we're saying is that Wendy and I believe in angels. We believed Elder Holland when he said,
"Pray without ceasing. Ask for angels to help you."
Think about that. Ask for angels to help you. Then we believed him also when he said that angels could be dispatched to help us. And then he explained further,
"Usually such beings are not seen. Sometimes they are. But seen or unseen, they are always near. Sometimes their assignments are very grand and have significance for the whole world. Sometimes the messages are more private. Occasionally, the angelic purpose is to warn. But most often, it is to comfort, to provide some form of merciful attention, guidance, in difficult times.
We have both had far too many experiences with those from the other side of the veil to ever doubt their presence or their involvement in our lives. If you want to have a truly great experience, read the Book of Mormon again, marking every time angels ministered to someone here on earth. Pay attention to why they came, what they taught, what they did to minister to a mortal man or woman, and the difference it made in those people's lives.
I taught Elder Holland's teachings to our Institute students, and one, whom I'll call Barbara, followed through with Elder Holland's counsel with amazing results. Barbara has served as proxy for many of my ancestors. She had special proxy experiences with a woman named Genevieve and with Genevieve's biological sisters. So Barbara prayed and asked if Genevieve and her sisters, all who live on the other side of the veil, could be dispatched to help Barbara's own sister who lives on this side of the veil. Barbara's sister had not been active in the church for years. She was having heart-wrenching difficulties with some really rigorous life events. Here are Barbara's own words. I prayed that my sister could find peace in this world, that she could find direction back to Heavenly Father, and that the sisters of Genevieve could help her find her way back and watch over her in this process. A few weeks later, my sister told me that she was taking her three boys to church. Later, she asked how to get her patriarchal blessing. The eldest boy turned 8 this summer and was baptized, and my sister is now attending temple preparation classes. I find that just so thrilling.
What Barbara was describing in every respect is a miracle. How can we explain miracles? Moroni told us, my beloved brothers, and may I add sisters, have miracles ceased? Behold, I say unto you, nay. Neither have angels ceased to minister unto the children of men. And the office of their ministry is to call men, and I believe women, to repentance, and to fulfill and to do the work of the covenants of the Father.
Here's what I know to be true. Family history and temple work will bring miracles to your life and to the lives of those you love. My dear brothers and sisters, we have loved our time with you today. And in closing, I just want to add that there is an urgency that accompanies this work. Many of you have felt it. My sense of urgency revved up because of what I experienced on June 15th, 2013. On that day, my husband and I woke up in Moscow, Russia, and ended the day in Yerevan, Armenia. That morning, I was privileged to gather with our wonderful Russian sisters for a sisters' meeting. When I ask our sisters to stand as the name of the tribe of Israel, as declared in their patriarchal blessing, was announced, we were all surprised and overwhelmed to realize that 11 of the 12 tribes of Israel were represented in that little gathering of less than 100 women. All but Levi were present. Later that day in Armenia, my husband and I met a young missionary who was of the tribe of Levi. He just happened to be from Gilbert, Arizona. So think of this, within one 24-hour period of time, I was with children from all of the 12 tribes of Israel. I couldn't believe it then, and I can't get over it yet. These are indeed the latter days. Israel is being gathered on both sides of the veil. There has never been a time like this in the history of this earth ever. And this is our time to do what we covenanted premortally to do. We promised premortally to help our family members who would never have a chance to hear the gospel here on earth. Now, as my husband and I travel, we see many signs. There is one in every airport that chokes me up every time. Ticketed passengers only beyond this point. I immediately think of those on the other side of the veil who are in prison, unable to move forward with their lives, unable to progress, to grow, to ever be with their families, unless something changes. The only way for those prisoners to become ticketed passengers is by our efforts to find their qualifying information and then to perform their proxy ordinances. Those essential exalting ordinances are the ticket they need for eternal life. We are the ones who can turn our ancestors and our cousins into ticketed passengers. And now is the time for each of us to find joy as we find, take, and teach. It is my testimony, my dear brothers and sisters, that family history and temple work is the Lord's work. We know He can do His own work. So just think of how generous He is to let us participate. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Sherry?
I have admitted today that I've been a slacker about family history, but I haven't been a slacker about temple worship and temple service. The pressures and disappointments of my life would have crushed me long ago if it weren't for being in the temple a lot. I've learned for myself that the promises in the 109th section of the Doctrine and Covenants are true, that when we emerge from the temple, we emerge armed with power, that it is in the temple that we grow up in the Lord and receive a fullness of the Holy Ghost, that the temple is a house of knowledge and revelation and peace. The temple puts this world and everything in it in perspective. If you haven't yet established a pattern of regular temple service, and if you live within a reasonable distance of a temple, may I say to you what my stake present said to me several decades ago before I started to attend regularly. He said, Sherry, just go. Go and see what the Lord will teach you. It'll change your life. And it has. These last few years, I have loved, as I've been going to the temple, helping so many of my dearest friends' family. But I know that the temple would mean even more to me if the names were from my own line. So, Elder Renland, with Grandma Dew and thousands of witnesses, I accept the challenge. I don't know how. I'll make it work. I'm not busy really between midnight and 5 a.m., and Wendy tells me that's often heaven's time, so maybe that's when it'll be. There may be some of you here who are slackers too, and not because you're not deeply committed to the Lord, but just because you haven't figured out how to make it fit, like I haven't. So my question today, and really my invitation, is will you join me? Will you join me in accepting Elder Renland's challenge to find as many names as ordinances you perform? If we will all begin and just try, I wonder how many people we can bless on both sides of the veil. I never get over the magnificence and the majesty, the power and the saving nature of the gospel of Jesus Christ. I love the work of the Lord, and I testify that the work of salvation is the only work that will ultimately matter. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
Can I have the two of you join me over here, please? Both of you, Sister Nelson. Don't you love these two friends? I had a thought as I was sitting there watching you, something that we hadn't planned. I'd like to ask each of you a question, if I may.
We love being spontaneous, especially at this moment.
Good. I loved the, did you love her camera work on her little cell phone? Wasn't that fun? How did you get President Russell M. Nelson, President of the Quorum of the 12 Apostles, to do this impromptu kind of thing for you?
All I had to do was ask. He'll do anything for me.
Do you know what he told me?
What?
I asked him at lunch. I said, how did that happen? He said, I had to do it so I could get my supper.
Okay, well, that too.
Okay. Now, Sister Dew, you made a big commitment here in front of a lot of folks.
Very terrifying.
Yes. Mm-hmm. As you were doing that, just now a thought came to me. I remembered a quote from President Boyd K. Packer. This is one you have to think about. He said, things that don't change tend to remain the same. Think about it. All right? So with that commitment, something will probably have to change in your life to achieve what you just committed to do. Have you thought about what that might be?
I have been thinking about it, and I haven't figured it out yet, but there has to be time, and there has to be time to make that work, and I think I can. I thought long and hard before I made the commitment here, and I felt kind of pushed, probably from Grandma Dew, actually, is probably celebrating somewhere else, thinking, finally, my granddaughter's paying attention. So something will have to change, and I'll figure it out. I don't yet know exactly when or how, but it'll work.
I'm waiting for you to say that you're going to give up Scrabble on your iPad.
I'm sure I'm going to have to give up something. The question is what?
Okay, you made my point.
I'll have to give up something.
Now, here we have lots of folks. Some of these folks are dyed in the wool genealogists, et cetera. Some of us are not, okay? So here's what I'd invite each of you to do to think about. Number one, as you listen to these two sisters, first question, what did you learn? And the second question, what did you feel? It was wonderful for me to feel the spirit of these two sisters as they shared their personal experiences with us. But your time can be even more meaningful if you choose to make a commitment in response to what you've learned and felt here. So we invite you to select one idea that has been expressed here and make it a part of your life. You may choose to accept the apostolic temple challenge and make both halves of the blessing a part of your personal life, part of your personal worship, finding family names and performing ordinances for them in the temple and helping others to do the same. Now, Sister Dew accepted that challenge in front of 20,000 people and in front of Sister Nelson and Grandma Dew.
And Sister Nelson is the scariest.
Yeah.
By the way.
Because I bet she's going to follow up.
She will follow up.
So here's what I invite you to do. Identify what you will sacrifice. You could do that as one of these choices of something to do. Just like Sister Nelson gave up Scrabble for 2 months. You may choose to help someone else find a family name and perform ordinances that they can take to the temple. Or you may, I loved what Sister Nelson said about, you may ask for help from the other side of the veil and then watch and listen. In conclusion, I think of the message given by the angel Moroni. The Renlands referred to that in their time. Given by the angel Moroni, September 21st, 1823, when he said that Elijah, the prophet, would come, and quote, and he shall plant in the hearts of the children the promises made to the fathers, and the hearts of the children shall turn to their fathers. If it were not so, the whole earth would be utterly wasted at his coming. Years later, the prophet Joseph spoke regarding that statement, and he said, quote, the earth will be smitten with a curse unless there is a welding link between the fathers and the children. For we without them cannot be made perfect, neither can they without us be made perfect. Eternal families, sealed for time and all eternity. There are both halves of this blessing that need to come into play in our own personal lives. The blessing of family history work and temple work. May the spirit of Elijah be poured out upon each one of us, that we will not only know this that we've heard today, but that we will do it. That is our prayer and my witness in the name of Jesus Christ, amen.